And welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity. I'm the RPG Chick. We are in 2.0. The 2.0 edition here. Technically, I think it's 2.00.0706. Anyway, I've not bought the expansion yet. I'm gonna buy it soon. I might not even install it until I finish the main game. Just to keep everything separate, I suppose. You know, it's for Let's Play purposes. Not sure if we're going to get into any combat this episode. Probably not. Unless we get into a bar fight or something like that, because we're not finished exploring Dyrford Village. We've been in this home. We've been, well, this mill. We've been in this church. We've explored all the outsides. We still have to look at all these areas. And I'm not sure if we can go in these or not. So, that's that. However, we can mess with the AI behavior, which I find very interesting. I look forward to seeing how this will work in a battle. Okay, so as far as class behavior, well, everyone has this auto attack thing. Defend self. Passive. The character will not move to attack automatically under any circumstances. Defend self, which everyone is currently set to by default. The character will not move to attack unless they're engaged by an enemy. If that enemy is defeated, they will seek out new enemies to attack. Okay, defensive. The character will actively seek out nearby enemies for attack, regardless of whether or not they're being directly attacked. And aggressive. The character will equal... It's the same, is it? We'll seek out nearby enemies. We'll seek out enemies. Okay. So this is nearby. Aggressive isn't. So for... Theodess, anyway. I'm gonna keep it as a default. Defend self. I'm not using per rest abilities on anybody. It's just going to use up, you know, my spells and all that fun stuff. I'm not sure if Theodess has any per rest abilities. I don't think they are. Anyway, class behavior, either none or damage you set to default. The cipher begins with a physical attack and then focuses on using powers that emphasize damage, like Mind Wave and Soul Shock. Ones I ordinarily use anyway. As a secondary emphasis, the Cypher uses crowd control abilities like Eye Strike, Tenuous Grasp, and Whisper of Treason. Defensive. The Cypher opens with a physical attack and then focuses on using powers that emphasize personal or support defense like Psycho Vampiric Shield, Pain Link, Body Augment... No, Attunement. Pain Block, Wild Leech, and Tactical Meld. If these aren't available, the Cypher will fall back on a mix of damage and crowd control spells. And then crowd control opens with a physical attack. Oh, I can't even move this. Okay. And then focuses on using powers that emphasize crowd control, like Eye Strike, Tenuous Grasp, and Whisper of Treason. The secondary emphasis, the Cypher uses damaging abilities like Mind Wave and Soul Shock. I'm going to make this none because I really want to control my own character, as it were. Aloth. Now this is always going to be the same, so I'm going to keep him as defend self. This is what I ordinarily do anyway for damage, using arcane assault as soon as combat opens. Yeah. I don't want them damaging each other with friendly fire though. I think Arcane Assault is foe only, but I have to check that. If Per Rest is enabled, I mean, I guess if I don't have that enabled, it does nothing. Arcane Veil and or Grimoire Slam. As soon as they are engaged in melee. Kind of like that. And then Spell Sword. Again, not enabled, so I guess he wouldn't do anything. I don't know. Let's put him defense. In case he's hit, use Arcane Veil and or Grimoire Slam. Of course, these are always overrid by if you put input commands yourself. From what I understand, if I'm casting Fireball and he gets hit, interrupted by somebody, he should still keep trying to cast Fireball. Never mind the Fireball, let's do Grimoire Slam on this guy that just interrupted me and hit me. That's what I'm thinking. Anyway, Adair. Aggressive. The fighter uses Knockdown and Disciplined Barrage at the first opportunities. Clear Out will automatically be used whenever the fighter has three enemies in range if per rest is enabled. What? Isn't Clear Out per combat? I thought it was. I kind of like that anyway. And then Hold Ground. The fighter uses Vigorous Defense when engaged by more than two opponents. Uses Unbending when below 50% endurance if per rest is enabled. Defender is enabled by default, which I already have, and if disabled, will be re-enabled at the start of the next combat. I like Aggressive, so I don't have to, you know, automatically... I mean, I don't have to specifically do that, and I like the way... I have to check out the Clear Out thing. Because I figured that was per combat as well. So I kind of like Aggressive, and I like having him actively seek out enemies. I might change that, because I don't like when everyone attacks different enemies. I mean, that happens often enough as it is because of placement and people being, you know, actively engaged in melee. I don't like to have him run off and get hit just to hit the same enemy. It's tricky sometimes. Anyway, Durance. The priest uses Interdiction for Aggressive as soon as combat begins. Per rest is enabled, blah blah blah. I'm not going to read that because I'm not doing that. It's like every combat you get in is going to be your last for that day, and I don't play that way. Support. The priest uses Holy Radiance whenever someone in the party is below 33% endurance, or if two or more people are below 50% endurance. I use Holy Radiance at the beginning of every combat. Interdiction. Rusty here. I don't even know what that is. I'm just going to put none for that. And yeah, I'm just going to keep it like that. And Kanna. This will be helpful because I'm not good at playing Kanna. I have not taken the time to see all his chants. I basically let him do the chants that he's always been doing and you know, make him hit his enemies. So Aggressive emphasizes offense-oriented invocations like Hell, Hiraf crashed upon the shield, the thunder rolled like waves on seas, thrice she was wronged, thrice justly avenged, and white worms writhed in the bellies of the dead. Gotta love that one. If these are not available, summons are prioritized over support invocations. Kinda like him being supporter, and at the same time hitting his enemies. So for summoner, prioritize summons like, but deny a rarit's ghost, he would not rest, and if their bones still slept under that hill, none could say. If these are unavailable, support invocations are emphasized over aggressive invocations. I kind of look interested in seeing the summons. I mean, I don't know if I have to prepare them before this, or if this selecting that will do it. Support. Chanter emphasizes support-oriented invocations like not felled by the axe, not broken by the storm, and summons like, but deny Rarit's ghost, he would not rest, and if their bones still slept under the hill, nothing can say. Blah, blah. Prioritizes team support invocations over summons. So I'm going to have him as summoner and see what that does. Although I technically I like the support. I like that idea, so we'll try out the summoner one, and if you know, I might just change to support after. And last but not least, of course, Pallegina. Okay, so class behavior aggressive. Uses flames of devotion and sworn enemy at the first opportunities if caress is enabled. Zealous focus is enabled by default, and if disabled, will be re-enabled to start next combat. I'm pretty much sure I already have zealous focus on by default and flames of devotion. So kind of like that. So ready, what I already do, and then class behavior uses lay on hands whenever an ally is below 50% endurance. Kind of like that. But the problem is, you know, I kind of like having to decide that myself. Like, she's engaged with another character, and someone falls below 50%, she's going to run off and get an attack of opportunity, or whatever they call it in this game, on herself to cast lay hands on, you know, Adair, who's on the other side of the screen. I don't know about that. I'm going to have to see how this plays out. Uses liberating exhortation whenever an ally is subjected to a hostile status effect with a duration of over 5 seconds. Uses reinforcing exhortation on an ally that's being attacked by more than 2 enemies. Uses reviving exhortation on the first ally to be knocked unconscious in combat. And the rest is per enabled. Zealous Defoe Endurance is enabled by default, and if disabled, re-enabled star of the next encounter. I like that too. You know what? I'm gonna have her do this. I'm gonna see if she starts running off and getting attacks of opportunity on herself to cast this stuff. I mean, lay on hands, I'm pretty sure she has to be next to that character. I'm not sure about the others. So. And defend self. I'm gonna have her be defensive, seeking out nearby enemies. Of course, if I just have her do what I want to do, she's not going to do any of this crap anyway. It's going to override. So that's that. Then there's also a nice new logo screen that comes up for Obsidian. And I can't show you that, unfortunately, because whenever I hit my key to start Fraps recording, it makes the screen go away. Yeah, let's check out Trygil's Curriery. Curriery? Trygil? And I am, unfortunately, recording with Fraps. I've been using Shadowplay for my other game, which is Postal 2. I can't find it anywhere. Do we interrupt something? Unfortunately, Shadowplay won't even play, won't even record this at all. When we're on a loading screen, you guys might see in the upper right-hand corner a frame rate counter. That's Shadowplay's frame rate counter. That's all it'll give me. It won't record. So we're with Fraps on this. So I'm not uninstalling that yet. What do we have in here? Tab, yeah. It's been couple weeks since I played this. Dyes fill the wooden vats. They smell of dung and plant matter. Let's see what's in here. Yeah, I'm not gonna take that. Trygil, and that's Saban. I'm not one for chit-chat, elves. Speak to Trygil if you've got questions.
How do you do?
A sturdy, broad-shouldered man wipes his hands on his slacks. He reeks of the same foul compound wafting from the vats, and his arms are stained with dye. You looking to purchase some leather? What's in the collapsed tower? It's collapsed. Nothing. He rolls his eyes and shrugs. A few hides on stretching racks and the tallow stench Dengler's always grumbling about. The rest of the keep's dust, just like the fool Lady Thanu who tried to hold it. There's a bard at the inn who'll tell you the whole blazing story if you want to hear it. He wipes a splotch of dye from his elbow with his shirt tail. Something else you need? Rumbold mentioned something about an ogre. He's hardly talked about anything else since those pigs of his went missing. The whole town's been worried about that monster. People are starting to see shapes in their windows at night, hearing its growl and the snorting of their mates. Snoring, sorry. It would put a lot of minds at ease if someone got rid of it. He scrapes at red pigment under his fingernails. I sometimes venture into the wilderness, collecting ingredients for my dyes, mind you. I've seen tracks east of here, near the river, that couldn't have been anything else. Have you seen Nifer and Orlin from Defiance Bay? I make it a point to keep out of other people's business. Show me what you have for sale. Ooh, exceptional dagger. I don't want that. I was wanting to look at it. Yeah. Basic dagger description. So it's exceptional in fine things. Ooh, and a girdle of mortal protection and a troll hide belt. Is it worth looking at? Though a simple band of dark leather, this particular girdle provides a defense against killing blows, turning a blade aside at the final moment, or else cushioning a strike from a blunt object. Minus 27 crit damage take. It's pretty cheap. Wait. Oh, that's our price. Wait. Value 110. He's selling it for 825. Man, these guys get away with murder. And the troll hide belt. Plus one endurance for 3 seconds. 3 seconds? This belt has been crafted from the mossy hide of a forest troll, with intertwined vines and leaves forming a solid and resistant piece of clothing. Any damage done to the belt tends to be obscured by new growth, for the moss and small plants which grow upon the belt retain some life, though the resulting effect is somewhat like wearing an herb garden around one's waist. The piece of hide holds some of the troll's power, granting the wearer the creature's ability to recover from wounds. 3 seconds, though. Sheesh. I kind of like this. We only have one? I'll buy it. Sell this crap. Any duplicates of books here? Rumbold mentioned that the ogres were spotted around Dyrford, but he wasn't sure exactly where it dwells. Yeah, Trygil told me the ogre most likely resides near the Bale River east of Dyrford Village. Dyrford Village. I can't say Dyrford Village. Let's keep saying Dyrford. Dyrford! Alright, where's this belt? Did we put it in? Wait, she's got it. Okay, Theodas, you got a belt. What belt does he have? Oh, he has the same one, Aloth. Now we match. We need belts for people. We don't have belts.
I can do that.
Oh, wait. Stay out of my private quarters. That goes for you and Haran's bootlickers. It's wrong door. Sorry. I didn't mean to do that. I don't even remember who Haran is. Okay, this is a Dracogen Inn. Apothecary we've been to. And Winfrith? I guess we're going this way? Where's the door for Winfrith? Right here. Hail! What's this? Oh, you could keep the caravan. Vale Laren. Oh, we got a story here. You see a forest clearing, fog curling through the weeds on the ground in the cold morning air. The serenity of the scene is occasionally broken by a faint noise that echoes through the silence. This woman emerges from the trees and stops, dropping to the ground. She creeps to the edge of the clearing and crouches near a tree. She glances around furtively, listening intently in the growing light. She presses her back to the tree, tensing against it, ready to spring forward. From the distance comes another sound, a rustling in the undergrowth. At that, she shoots forward, keeping as low to the ground as she can. She puts a hand to her throat and makes a sound, a shrill bird call, but what emerges from her mouth seems to emanate from yards away. From behind her, near the source of the rustling, there is a brief grunting noise that is quickly silenced. She dives into a large bush at the edge of the tree line, keeping her head down and wriggling silently through the leaves and twigs. She takes a position in the bushes, turning to face the direction she came. She raises her hand again, this time mimicking a Stelgar, placing the roar directly behind the men failing to sneak up on her. More than one voice answers this call, all of them sounding panicked and hurried, all of them quickly moving this way, all thoughts of stealth forgotten. She backs out from under the bush to crouch behind it. As she pulls her bow from her back, she takes a shooting stance and waits for her hunters to appear. Clever, aren't you?
Hello.
Hello. A portly, smiling man stands behind a warped wooden counter, polishing a buckler. He looks up. Haven't seen you before. Always glad to see a new face in town. Company's good for business and chatter's good for the soul. That's what I always say. Anyhow, what can I do for you? What's been going on in Dyrford? Dyrford, my god. Oh, we're a quiet little town and not much happens here. Especially not since the legacy hit. People realized they couldn't have babies and just stopped trying altogether. And that takes a lot of excitement out of the day-to-day, if you can believe it. Show me what you have for sale. Tall grass. Huh. I love reading this stuff. Hopefully there aren't too many. They all have these little stories to them. So this is a pike, a two-handed pike. It's an exceptional weapon. A group of Adirian pikemen were so disciplined in battle that they garnered the attention of the Fearconing himself. He made them members of his personal retinue and ordered special weapons fashioned for them. They marched at the head of his procession, their movement perfectly synchronized and their pikes swaying like blades of grass in the wind. The pikemen became a public favorite during royal festivals and parades, and both they and their weapons earned the nickname Tall Grass. I don't want to be using a pike, so... stuff's expensive anyway. The Hours of St. Rumbold, a unique great sword. St. Rumbold was among the first of the Eothasian, I believe it is, pilgrims to take up the Emperor's offer of settlement in the distant territory of Red Saris. A dedicated priest of the Shining God, Rumbald was regarded as a leader in his community, known both for his unwavering dedication to his congregation and his stern vigilance against lapses in doctrine. What survives of his sermons reflects this duality, for he emphasized the redemptive power of the faith, even as he warned against the dire punishments awaiting those who rejected Aethys' beneficence. Colonization efforts brought Eothasian settlers into direct conflict with the native Orland populations, and Rumbald was among those credited with routing several brutal attacks upon the settlement. Ultimately, however, Rumbald was mortally wounded during a violent raid. Witnesses claim that upon the moment of his death, Rumbald's body was suffused by an overwhelming burst of light, knocking the remaining Orland warriors flat or else scattering them back into the forest. Accounts arose of Rumbald's final hours, describing the great miracles which were described to have occurred during the day preceding his death. Aethys, it was said, had informed Rumbald of his fate, and the priest accepted this gladly and without fear, for he knew that death was only the first step in his final 27 hours, and with a miraculous act such that his congregation would know him by the gift Aethys bestowed upon him, and continued Rumbald's work in his stead. Rather than staunch the flow of Eothasian settlers, Rumbald's death only encouraged more pilgrims to venture across the sea, eager to set their eyes upon the final resting place of Aethys' favored servant. The Hours of St. Rumbald was forged in dedication to this patron saint of the resettlement, and its blade is inscribed with markings counting the 27 hours before Rumbald's passing. In such a manner was the blade imbued with the saint's power. It was said that a man might kneel before the sword and know with precision the moment of his death. Interesting. Grudgekeeper we might have seen before. That's not a long description, I'll just read it. I don't know if we've seen it before, but these are the stats. Unique rod. One of the many Orland slaves freed by the 10 Years' Treaties, Maswin Cass swore vengeance against those who had wronged her and her people. Gathering a small group of fellow freed Orlands to perform night raids on known slavers. She would go on to join the Greff's forces in putting down the Cooper's Rebellion, if in an unofficial capacity, and it was at this point that she acquired an ornately carved rod from the home of a wealthy slave owner. Every time Cass brought down a foe, she would scratch a notch into the rod she wielded. By the time she lost possession of it, the rod bore a crisscross pattern across along its length that many assumed was part of its original design. And Wittesi's Thorn. Unique spear. Fine weapon. The sight of Wittesi on the battlefield was something no combatant ever forgot. Stocky and short, even by Orland standards, Wittesi insisted on using a spear in lieu of any other weapon offered him. To the frequent shock of his comrades, Wittesi proved an unstoppable force on the battlefield. No matter how overwhelming the odds, Wittesi could take down opponents with almost comical ease, leaping great heights to bring his spear down upon his foes with crushing force. Whenever it seemed that Wittesi might at last meet his end, the fearless Orland would find a second wind and fight with renewed conviction. Pretty cool. Mosquito? Unique rapier. How much are they selling this for? 3038. Who's... One of us is using a rapier. Let me just look at it. Compare. Oh, that's a stiletto. Oh, I don't... An S-stock. Hmm. think Firebrand was using a rapier. Greatsword. Hmm. Mosquito. This finely crafted but unassuming rapier was created in the hot and humid forest of the Sithwood. Its first owner was a minor nobleman named Aedwin Granmeth, known in social circles for his obsequious manner and annoying habit of lingering too long where he was not wanted. Aedwin had little use for the blade in the courts he frequented. When Aedwin died an unnotable death, the blade passed to a young niece, Calend Grunmef. She found that the weapon had characteristics of her uncle, good at interrupting at inopportune times, draining the life out of anyone it came in contact with, and a generally annoying presence. It was Cadend who gave the rapier its nickname, Mosquito, and used it regularly in court duels. The weapon passed to Aedwin's grandson in the Deerwood upon her death. A thane of Quinsrun? He was lost during a Glanfathan raid. Mosquito was lost with him, as he had no descendants and none of the Granmeths of Edir have made a claim on the rapier. It has circulated among anonymous Glanfathan and Deerwooden owners ever since. I've got a bunch of fine weapons. Angios Gambleson? Unique light armor. Fine armor. Grants deleterious alacrity of motion, one per rest. The renowned Valian acrobat, Angio, wore this garment while performing jaw-dropping feats that seemed to defy the laws of nature and the standards of good defense. He would leap and tumble across wires suspended high above the ground, and while there is no evidence that this gambeson actually reduced his intelligence, his concern for safety lessened as his fame and skill grew. He forswore the wearing of safety harnesses and, eventually, the use of any kind of safety rope, claiming that these tethers limited his ability to perform. While his skill never failed him, one of his tight ropes unfortunately did. He plunged to his death at the foot of Ansenzi Fortress. More fine stuff. Boots of Zealous Command. An officer in a dark hosy Paladini of Old Valia first wore these. Usable by Paladin. Plus 20% Zealous or Aura Area of Effect. It was said that those under her command knew her by the sound of her approach and stood a little straighter in her presence. She was known throughout the Order for her inspirational leadership. It's for boots. Hold on a second. She doesn't even have boots.
I'm ready.
Zealous focus.
Gods keep you.
I should get that for her. Zealous Aura? Okay, is Zealous Focus and Zealous Aura two different things? Gotta be the same thing. I'm gonna do is I'm going to save this. I'm going to see if this improves this. If not, I mean, let's sell it back. I'll just restore the save. What do you think, guys? How far am I into the game? How much more do I have to go? 116, so I'm about 58 hours in, something like that. Maybe a little more. Okay, so now... plus 4.7 meters.
Hail, traveler.
Did increase 5.2 meters. Good. Good.
How do you do?
Got some new boots, so we're doing good. Let's see how much we have more to go. Pry bar, hammer. Okay, this is the last one. Voice of the Mountaintop. It's an amulet. Plus 20 chant area of effect. Only usable by chanter. We don't even have a chanter. But I want to read the story, and then we'll call it an episode. So if you guys don't want to hear a story, you can just tune out now, alright? Dwarven chanters of the White March are said to have mastered projection techniques to such a degree that they can trigger distant avalanches with their voices. Whether or not this specific... Wait, the... what's his name? Is a chanter. Where's my head today? Crap. I can't remember his name either. Kana. I had to see his face first. Plus 20 area of effect. Anyway, yeah, dwarven chanters of the White March are said to have mastered projection techniques to such a degree that they can trigger distant avalanches with their voices. Whether or not this specific rumor is true, they are known to chant between peaks and across rugged valleys, exchanging messages with their brethren across great distances. This amulet was forged by an ancient order of druids in the White March, precursors to the Ethic Knoll of Twin Elms. It was worn and passed down from one watchman to the next, men and women who stood guard atop the high peaks, ready to warn their fellows of approaching armies. See, I don't know. Do we want to give up the minor cloak of protection? I mean, these are good increases here. I mean, am I... Oh, he actually... No, he has this unwavering resolve, which is better. He's got plus 2 intellect and plus 1 resolve. I kind of like that. Alright, guys. We're done.
Looking good.
At his stuff, and that's...
Eh?
And that's good, I hear. Thanks for watching. See you in the next episode. We're going to go to the inn next. We're actually going to look around. There's a building or two that has no description. It's these two. I want to see if there's a door to go in. And other than that, yeah, we're definitely checking out Dracogen Inn next episode. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.